separate notebook for each of the subjects. Maintain a separate notebook for doing the homeworks as well. Okay? And be regular. I don't want you to complete the homework. I want you to attempt the homework. Try to understand the difference. And when it comes to attempt, your honesty comes into play. When you say, sir, I attempted all these questions, I didn't get any one of them, I'll be happy. I don't want to see the answers coming up. I want to see you making honest attempts. So first thing is, in this exam, be honest with yourself. You're not preparing this exam for anybody. You're preparing this for yourself. It is not even for your parents. Your parents are already well settled, well to do their thing. Your success would not, or your failure will not hamper them. Of course, your success will make a lot of difference to their happiness. But to me also. So you are writing this exam for yourself. Keep reminding yourself every moment when you get deviated that I'm writing this exam for myself. So bridge course, as other teachers would have already apprised you, is basically bridging the gap between your 10th and your 11th. There are certain tools in maths, in physics and in chemistry which you would be required to know beforehand. Why? Because multiple teachers would be dealing with you at tandem. Some teacher would have started chapter X, some teacher would have started chapter Y, and you may be lost in, you know, balancing those chapters, and you may miss out on certain important ingredients or tools or tricks that you should be knowing in order to handle it. So bridge course in maths would comprise of certain chapters which is not going to be officially taught to you, but you would be expected to use them. The first being, in maths, graph and its transformations. Okay? Many of us, we know maths only in terms of numbers and equations. How many of you have tried solving questions by plotting the graphs? Just in one chapter you had, I think, last year. Which chapter? Linear equations, correct? Apart from that, we use graphs to solve the questions very, very rarely, correct? That is not going to work in 11th and 12th. If you are clear about the concept, if you want to really save your time solving the problem, you need to take the approach of making graphs. And there is no chapter called graphs in your class 11th and 12th. You may have bought your books also for 11th and 12th. I will tell you the list of books as well. Okay, apart from the study material that we'll be offering you. There is no chapter called graphs, unfortunately. But if you turn to a JEE Advanced paper or JEE Main paper and see the solutions, you will see a lot of graphs being plotted there. Many of us think this chapter, this way of solving the problem is optional. Right? Maths has to be mainly solved by using equations and numbers and formulas. Graph is optional. Sometimes graph may be the only way to solve the problem. And if you're writing JEE Advanced, graph can save lot of time because graph is worth 1,000 words. Correct? Picture is worth 1,000 words, right? I changed it to graph is worth 1,000 words, right? Because for you, picture is a graph. So if I tell something about a person and I don't show his picture, what kind of void gets created in your mind? The same void will be getting created if I tell you about a function and I don't show its graph to you. Correct? The moment you see its graph, you will be able to assess the characteristic of it. Whether it's even, whether it's odd, whether it's increasing, whether it's decreasing, whether it has corners, whether it is smooth, whether it is break, it has breakage somewhere, or whether it's continuous throughout. Or what is the extension of the graph? What is the extension of the graph along y-axis, x-axis? Everything will be very evident once you know the graph. And unfortunately, this chapter is not there in your chapter list, but used everywhere. Correct? So graph is something which I said I thought I would be telling you so that when you start learning maths, you have a different perspective about that particular concept. Okay? You just don't learn it like figures and numbers. Second thing that you would be immediately required, I think physics sir has already started with vectors, correct? And he would be soon talking in terms of calculus as well. So there will be a session on intro to calculus where I will be telling you what is the concept of limits, what is the concept of differential calculus, what are the concept of integral calculus, and what was the rationale behind coming up with a modern day field of maths called calculus. Right? I call it as a modern day field of maths because older days were geometry, right? Which you learned in class 10th. Geometry was very old. Then came the concept of algebra. And then came the concept of calculus. So how calculus is going to shape up your math syllabus and of course physics and to a certain extent chemistry, we'll be talking in the calculus. The third chapter is trigonometry, which will also overlap with the trigonometry of your class 11th. So after finishing these two, when I start trigonometry, I'll continue with the flow of your school as well. In your school also, probably the first or the second chapter would be trigonometry. Okay, and as you would all know that we are aligning with your school curriculum. So whatever your school doing, the same thing we will be also doing with you. So you don't have to study multiple chapters at the same time. Okay, so what is your expectation from graphs? What do you think will come up in graphs? Yes. Anybody who is having some expectations, so I am going to talk about graphs. What are you going to see in graphs? Huh? A parabola. Okay, it's not parabola. It's a parabola. Okay? Yeah, I know in Indian curriculum we tend to pronounce it incorrectly. It's a parabola. Okay? What's a parabola, by the way? Yeah, so when you throw something, the path or the trajectory of that object is a shape which we call as a parabola. Of course, parabola will come. Basically, we are learning how to do a pictorial representation of functions. What are functions? That's why the bridge course is there, because you'll hear a lot of things which you've never heard before. Oh, functions, what is functions? Okay, to give you a simple example, when I write a expression like this, y is equal to x plus 3, correct? What I'm doing is, I'm trying to relate the two variables here. What are the two variables here? X and y. What is x called officially? An independent variable, right? So normally we call x as an independent variable. Okay, independent variable. And y is called a dependent variable. Okay, so when you write something like this, y is equal to x plus 3, you are actually relating x with y. Correct? So in the language of maths, we say that this is a relation. Relation between what? Relation between the two variables x and y. But this is like an expression. If you show this pictorially, then that picture is called the graph of this relation. Now, how would I draw the picture for this? It's not a landscape that I know, see and okay, sketch it like this. Correct? How do I draw a picture of a relation? By plotting it against an xy axis, isn't it? So what we do is, we choose an x and then see what is the y corresponding to it. That's why when we choose an x, there is no criteria for choosing it. Hence the name independent was given to it. Because I can choose it as 0, 1, 10, 100, minus 1, 2.4. But whatever I choose, my y becomes dependent on it. Correct? So let's say if I choose x as 1, can y take any value? No, it will be taking a value of 4. So 1, 4. If you plot, let's say 1 comma 4 is this point, right? Yeah, 1 comma 4 is this point, correct? Again, if I put x as 0, what do I get? 3. So 0 comma 3 is this point. If I choose it as 2, what do I get? 5. 2 comma 5 is this point, let's say. Okay. And when I start joining all these points, I get the pictorial representation for this relation. I'm not calling it as a function right now, I'll come to it little later on. But what am I doing? When I'm connecting these points or all the points, which satisfy this relation, that means I am plotting the graph of it. Understood? So at every point, let's say I take a generic point here, x, what are you plotting? X comma y, and y is what? X plus 3. So if you choose your x, y will automatically get dictated by that x that you have chosen. Yes or no? So basically you can say that the picture that you have drawn, the graph that you have drawn, is basically a home to two such points which are related to each other. Just like we do it at our home, right? Will your dad allow to stay in his house if you are not related to him? Will you keep me in your house? Of course not. Of course you. Some of you would say yes. But you never allow a stranger to be, you know, living in your house with you, correct? Only when you are related, you stay in a house. Yes or no? So this two variables are related to each other, and that's why they stay on this house called the graph. Simple analogy for you to understand. Anybody would understand this concept, isn't it? So what is a function then? This is a relation. What makes a relation a function? Now there's a very deep story behind this. Okay, so I'll try to tell you in short, because my aim is not to talk about functions in this particular class. My aim is to talk about graphs. But without functions, you'll never be able to understand what am I doing actually in this class. Okay, so just a brief introduction about functions. Now, functions are special relations. This is a relation, right? It may be a function, it may not be a function. Okay, so what makes a relation a function? To understand this, let me take you to the next slide. Relations versus functions. Anybody who has taken Ad Maths and sitting here, you would know about this. So what is the difference between a relation and a function?
I don't remember properly, but...
Layman language. I don't want mathematical jargon. See guys, if you... Einstein, you know Einstein? So he said that if you are able to explain a concept to somebody in a very simple term, that means you have understood the concept very well. Just a simple language. What's the relation? What's the function?
Function can be any sort of graph. Relation can be any sort of graph. But function is when for the same x value, there should not be more than one by that.
Okay. This is all you know? But you know almost 80% of the things. Okay, just the 20% I'll be adding to it. So what's a relation? Relation is a kind of operation which relates two sets, set A and set B, right? Where the set A is the set from where you pick your inputs, which we call as X, or the independent variables, what we call as X. And you map it to some element in set B. For example, if you recall, this was the example which I had taken in the previous slide. So let's say set A is a set which is made up of, all of you have seen a set in your past, right? Anybody who has never seen a set before? Let's say set A has 1, 2, 3, 4 as its elements. You all know that in a set, the elements are written only once, enclosed between flower brackets or curly brackets, whatever you call it. And let's say set B is a set which contains 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay? Now what are you doing is, you write the elements of set A in a oval shaped structure like this. This is called an arrow diagram structure. I will tell you why it's called an arrow diagram. You can see this arrow. Okay. So what do we do is, we see that under this relation, which element is mapping to which element of this set? So what is mapping to? So if you put a 1 over here, why should be 4? So we do a mapping of 1 with 4 and we show it by an arrow diagram like this. Anyways, you have to study this in your class 11th chapter called Relations and Functions. Okay? People who are in CBSE board, you would have already done it. Okay? Similarly, if I put 2, what is the answer that I am expecting? When I put 2, y should become 5. So this is a narrow diagonal. Okay. 3 will give me 6. 4 will give me 7. Okay. Now this set A is called the pre-image set. And set B is called the image set. Right? Because when you say you are mapping 1 to 4, 4 is called the image of 1. And 1 is called the pre-image of 4. Understood the naming? These namings you will come across many a times in maths. So that time you should not be like, what is pre-image? What is image? I don't know what is. So when you are mapping 1 to 4 under this relation, then 1 will be called the pre-image of 4, 4 will be called the image of 1. Is this nomenclature understood? Correct. The set from which the pre-images come is called the pre-image set. The set from which the images come is called the image set. Is that fine? Okay. So, if you have to plot the graph of this particular relation, I'm not using the word function as of now. If you have to plot the graph of this relation, what points will you plot on the xy coordinate system? 1, 4, 2, 5, 3, 6, 4, 7, like that. And you will start getting a graphical representation of that relation, isn't it? Okay.